suspect swallowed them. The suspect was sent to Queen Mary Hospital upon his arrest. He was hiding in a storeroom at a jewelry shop in a commercial building on Wellington Street when police arrived after the security alarm was triggered. Officers recovered 8 diamonds worth $5.4 million on the unarmed Jordanian suspect. The Israeli shop owner claims 9 diamonds are still missing. They weigh 180 carats and are valued at $6 million. Police believe the 22-year-old suspect swallowed those diamonds and will be keeping him in custody overnight. He's said to have acted alone. Meantime, a 38-year-old employee at the shop was also sent to hospital. Authorities believe she was assaulted by the alleged robber. The Legislative Council House Committee will hold a meeting to discuss co-location arrangements at the Express Rail Link's West Kowloon terminus. But as Caleb Leung reports, the pro-democracy camp insists the public should be consulted.
The LegCo House Committee special meeting is initially planned for next Thursday. Issues surrounding the government's proposed co-location arrangements for immigration, customs and quarantine facilities at the Express Rail Link's West Kowloon terminus will be discussed. Since LegCo is now in summer recess, it's not immediately clear whether there will be enough members around to form a quorum for the meeting. The Secretary for Justice, Secretary for Transport and Housing, and Secretary for Security will be present if the meeting is held as planned. As for members of the pro-democracy camp, they have set up a
Let's give her our support. Let's encourage her to quit smoking.
The world will be different if you're willing to share. It's a beautiful thing to share life by giving blood.
Meanwhile, members of the pro-establishment camp are against the idea. Lawmaker Michael Tian says public consultations co-location concept have been going on for 7 years. The government has been answering all kinds of questions about why other arrangements are not feasible. 5 subsidiaries of the Federation of Trade Unions also held a press conference today to voice their support for the co-location plan. They said the arrangements would help boost the local economy and attract overseas tourists to Hong Kong, who would then use the express rail link to continue with their journey to different parts of the mainland. Caleb Leung, TVB News.
And here's Winner Wong with more details about the local section of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link.
Residents around the West Kowloon area have been living with blocked roads and having to make detours for over a year now. It's all because of construction works in relation to West Kowloon Station. The mega terminus will be the Hong Kong stopping point for the high-speed rail link. The MTR Corporation handed over documents to the Yao Chim Mong District Council today, with updates on the latest progress of the project. According to the papers, construction works are making good progress and facilities will gradually open in different phases. An underground transportation system near the terminus will be split into 3 floors. On the ground level, vehicles will be able to reach the station. One floor under will be the road leading to the West Kowloon Cultural District, the MTR Kowloon Station, and the surrounding Tsim Sha Tsui area. The lowest floor will have roads and public transportation leading to other districts within the city. The MTR Corporation says by September this year, it will be able to open some parts of Western Austin Road again. And by the end of this year, the entire Austin Road and Lin Cheng Road sections will be accessible to the public. The rail operator hopes the entire road system will be up and running by the first quarter of 2018. There will also be walkways connecting West Kowloon Station to the nearby Kowloon and Austin stations. Construction works on public transport interchanges are also progressing according to schedule. District councillors are hoping, as the roads are gradually released, traffic in the area can be eased up. Winner Wong, TVB News.
benefits. Think privacy. Be smart online. Don't download suspicious mobile apps. Don't use an easy-to-guess password for all accounts. Installing a webcam without security settings, footage could be intercepted. Ignoring privacy settings in a social network account,
A Democratic Party member said Albert Ho's cancer has not spread, but it's unclear if the 65-year-old requires other treatment. Taiwanese electronics giant Foxconn has announced plans to build an LCD display panel screen plant in the U.S. state of Wisconsin. The $10 billion U.S. dollar factory is being billed as the biggest economic development project in the state's history. Alan Buckner reports.
Foxconn is perhaps best known for assembling Apple iPhones in China. The company's chief executive officer said the Wisconsin factory, which will produce liquid crystal display panels used in televisions and computer screens, will help to better serve the U.S. market.
Why do it here? TV was invented in America. Yet, America does not have a single LCD fab to produce a complete 8K system. We are going to change that.
Foxconn selected Wisconsin in part because of a $3 billion incentives package the state offered. The announcement is a feather in the cap for U.S. President Donald Trump. He's being dogged by an investigation into Russian tampering in last year's presidential election, and plans for health care reform and tax cuts face a murky future in Congress.
This is a great day for American workers and manufacturing, and for everyone who believes in the concept and the label Made in the USA. The company's initial investment of more than $10 billion will create 3,000 jobs at a minimum, with the potential for up to 13,000 jobs in the very near future.
While it's not known yet where the plant will be, Racine County has been mentioned, and people there are excited.
I think it's great. I think it's going to provide a lot of jobs. We're going to have some construction.
Well, this area is in need of it because it basically a lot of the manufacturing jobs that were here in the past, a lot of them are gone.
I'm not going to end up working there. I'm just a flooring contractor, but I'm going to put flooring in all those people's homes. It's going to be great.
But Foxconn has a mixed record in following up on promises to create jobs in the U.S. In 2013, the company said it would invest $30 million U.S. dollars in a new factory in Pennsylvania, but the project was never completed. Alan Buchnia, TVB News.
President Donald Trump plans to ban transgender people from the U.S. military, in a move that's triggered outrage and confusion. Sonia Otero reports.
President Trump made the highly controversial announcement in a tweet. He said the government will no longer accept or allow transgender individuals to serve in any capacity in the U.S. military. Democratic lawmakers were quick to condemn the move.
It is a cruel and arbitrary decision designed to humiliate transgender Americans who have stepped forward to serve and defend our country.
And he didn't even have the courage to look them in the eye when he did it.
The decision all boils down to cost and military readiness. Trump insists transgenders burden the defense budget. The biggest cost includes having to pay for sexual reassignment surgeries for service members who decide to change their sex. Trump says it's unfair for the military to have to foot the bill for such a disruption.
We've done cost analyses and they total more than $3.7 billion over the next 10 years. And so we think it was definitely a wise decision of President Trump.
The estimated 2,500 transgenders currently serving and 1,500 in the reserves now fear they'll be ousted.
What do those discharges look like? Are they going to be honorable, less than honorable, dishonorable?
This transgender military veteran said the decision will incite hate.
I don't think there's any question that this is going to increase the danger factor for transgender folks who are already serving. They will, in all probability, probability once again become something of a target of witch hunts.
Transgender activists protested in New York.
What he does today is outrageous, disgusting, and dishonors the armed forces. Now we already know what this president thinks of immigrants. Now we know what he thinks about transgender people.
Confusion ran rampant when the Pentagon admitted they were caught off guard by the announcement. What's more, the Trump administration has yet to say whether it plans to kick out transgenders currently serving.
That's something that the Department of Defense and the White House will have to work together.
Sonia Artero, TVB News.
In Britain, a deadline has passed for the parents of Charlie Gard to agree to arrangements to spend more time in the hospice with their ailing son before he dies. However, it's unclear whether any compromise has been reached. James Aiken reports.
The 11-month-old baby, who suffers from an extremely rare genetic condition causing progressive brain damage and mental weakness, has been the subject of a bitter dispute between his parents and London's Great Ormond Street Hospital. Charlie has little time left before a ventilation tube that keeps him alive is finally removed. Over the weekend, Charlie's parents, Connie Yates and Chris Gard, reluctantly decided to let their child die. They had tried to get permission to take their son home, but at a court hearing yesterday, it became clear that would not happen because of logistical problems.
To be able to do things that normal parents do with their babies, to be able to bath him, cuddle him, and just spend a few days at home, you know, and let him pass his days as a normal little baby. Unfortunately, he's not allowed to do that.
Ever since Trump has been mostly stable and comfortable, and he is not in pain and not suffering. The judge ordered that the name of the hospice and the exact timing of Charlie's last moments should not be disclosed to the public. The case has triggered a heated international debate about who should decide a child's fate. It has even drawn comments from U.S. President Donald Trump and Pope Francis. Against the advice of doctors, Charlie's parents had wanted to take him to the U.S. to undergo an experimental treatment never before tried on anyone with his condition. Britain's courts, backed by the European Court of Human Rights, refused permission, saying it would prolong Charlie's suffering without any realistic prospect of helping him. James Aiken, TVB News.
Back locally, LegCo's Finance Committee chairman is complaining of slow progress in dealing with funding proposal requests. This is why he's considering tougher rules to prevent filibustering.
In reviewing the Finance Committee's work, its chairman said deliberations were too lengthy in the past legislative year.
On average, the committee spent a much longer time on items this year, which was 4.2 hours per item versus 2 hours last year. Members also frequently moved and spoke lengthily on procedure motions. All these contribute to the committee's slow progress in dealing with the funding proposals on the agenda.
He is contemplating tougher rules to limit the number of amendment motions lawmakers can raise.
Imagine you have 20 items and everyone is asked to discuss, then I would take many, many hours. So that is a very effective filibustering tool to me.
Despite the occasional disorderly behavior Chen Kinpo mentioned, lawmakers still held over 60 meetings on the government's funding requests. They approved 29 proposals involving $73 billion. There's been no short of drama and controversy on budgets the Finance Committee discussed. Chan does not intend to stay on as chairman in the next legislative year and suggested others to have a go.
Sports news. Day 4 of the swimming events at the World Aquatics Championships saw one local sensation break the Hong Kong record in the women's 200-meter freestyle final. Siobhan Hohe finished a respectable fifth in the race that was won by Italy's Federica Pellegrini. Jeff Tang reports.
Siobhan Hohe has raised the bar for Hong Kong swimmers after smashing her 200-meter freestyle record twice on her way to becoming the first local swimmer to make the finals of a world championship. She would break that mark again in the race with a new Hong Kong benchmark of 1 minute 56 seconds, good enough for fifth. The race was won by Beijing gold medalist Federica Pellegrini, who upset American Katie Ledecky's bid for a 13th world title. Speaking of upsets, Chinese star Sun Yang was the hot favorite to win the men's 800 meters freestyle, having claimed the last three titles. But he too, like Ledecky, was upstaged by an Italian. Gabriele Detti claimed Italy's second gold of the day, with compatriot Gregorio Paltrinieri in third. The Italians were split by Poland's Wojciech Wodiak, while Sun finished a distant fifth. In the mixed 4x100 meters medley relay, the United States smashed the world record with a 3-minute 38.56 second effort on their way to claiming their country's seventh gold medal. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
Mary, 對皮膚唔好㗎，唔好食煙啦。
你病，我心痛。
Mixed with sunny intervals, temperatures will range between 27 and 31 degrees. And that's the news. Thanks for watching. Good night.